Hello, welcome to Love Revival TV. My name is Brian Kaiser. Thank you so much for tuning in today. I'm here at Fredericksburg Prayer Furnace with David Bradshaw. Welcome on the show.
Thanks for having me.
And so you may be watching this on YouTube, live stream on Facebook right now, or you may be watching it on, hopefully on Roku by the time this is up, or on WAZT. But we just welcome you. David is an amazing, wonderful man of God who I love dearly. I really got touched radically by the Lord at Fredericksburg Prayer Furnace. Early on in my walk with the Lord, I don't know if I've ever even told you the story, but I was like 18 or 19, and I was, you know, getting into the things of God, but I was very unstable. I was telling them in the car, I was in that in-between of like, yeah, I love Jesus, but do I want a normal Christian life? Mm-hmm. Or do I want to go all out? Do I want to, you know, die for the gospel? And in Prayer Furnace, I think it was at the Fredericksburg Conference Center, Reinhard Bonnke was there, the Call of Virginia. It's like on my face for like 15 hours straight.
Wow.
And it was just like, this is worth everything.
Wow.
And here's other people that are saying, this is worth everything to love Jesus, to see revival, to go after missions and prayer and the spirit of the Tabernacle of David. And that was super hot in that conference. And so I just want to thank you.
Oh, man, that's awesome. I didn't know that story. That's cool.
It radically changed my life. And then that next year was when, you know, revival kind of broke out at Liberty.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So good times. But anyway, today we wanted to specifically talk about Awaken the Dawn. You know, Awaken the Dawn's been going for a while, and I'll let David tell you all about that. But they're doing a very interesting idea, a very different idea that has never been done before on the National Mall. So David, go ahead and tell them all about what's going on this year.
Yeah, well, I appreciate having me on, man.
Absolutely.
I never heard that story. That is super encouraging.
Yeah.
We prayed before every one of those gatherings. You know, we really felt all along that it was more of a movement than a conference.
True.
Not any sense of ownership over anything, but more just a sense of God's doing something more with prayer, missions, revival. And so that is really encouraging because we would do seasons of day and night prayer before every one of those.
Right.
And one of our biggest prayers was for guys like you.
Come on.
You know, and to hear the stories makes it just totally worth it. So
come on.
That's
so
super encouraging. Now you're doing this, traveling the world, preaching the gospel. I see the stories on social media. Just amazing.
It's
amazing. I'm just so encouraged.
Thank you.
By who you are, what you're carrying.
Thank you.
And what God's doing right now. So
thank you.
It's awesome. So anyways, it's good to be here. Yeah, to answer your question, we are going to the National Mall October 6th through 9th.
Come on.
We've done Awaken the Dawn events for, you know, since 2005. So, however long that is. 12, what is that? I can't even.
12,
crunch
yeah.
Numbers, man. But so, we've been doing it for years, and God has been powerfully moving, but never, you know, did we think in our own mind about what's transpiring now. This is one of those few times in my life personally where God spoke to us. You know, it's like that verse in Isaiah 30 where it says, a voice comes behind you and says, this is the way. There's a handful of times, at least in my life, where I go, this is one of those moments where if I don't act on this and take a major risk in faith, I'm going to regret it forever.
Mm.
And this is one of those moments. So we were just doing these conferences, gatherings, you were at some of them, you know, a few thousand, mostly young adults, and just really great things God did during those.
Yeah.
But in the middle of one of them, we were in a tent. I don't know if you were there in 2011.
No, I've watched some of the old ones. Bob was there.
Yeah, Bob Jones was there. John and Carol Arnett. Like, it was back. We had this massive, like, 5,000 person circus tent on a farm. I mean, and even how we got there was just so the Lord. I mean, we were doing the gatherings, like you said, in the conference centers and churches, but we didn't have a spot to do it in 2009 or in 2011, and that wasn't just super expensive, you know? And I had this out of the blue random dream of us doing the gathering in a tent. And I knew the name of the guy that owned the tent, for real, in the dream.
Right, but you didn't know him in the natural.
But I didn't know him in the natural. I just knew who he was, and I knew he had this massive... Morningstar used his tent. I mean, it was like this 5,000 person tent, you know?
Right.
But I knew who the guy was, but never met him. So he calls us, like, maybe a couple of weeks. I told our team here, I was like, hey, I dreamed this. It was a tent gathering, you know, and just explained it. And I said, I knew it was our gathering, but it was his tent. So he calls like a couple weeks later and basically goes, the Holy Spirit told me we're supposed to do something. What is it?
Wow.
Literally, we didn't know this guy.
Come on.
He called us just in obedience, you know?
Wow.
And so I went, well, man, we just dreamed. We're doing the gathering in your tent. So long or short of it, this guy's tent ends up on this farm in Virginia. We've got like a couple thousand young adults. Just a wild worship moment.
Uh-huh.
I mean, like, we literally tell stories from that moment. So this prophetic guy, Bob Jones, was there.
Good old Bob.
He's passed on, you know, to be with the Lord. But this was in 2011, so a couple of few years before he passed. And he didn't travel as much then, so it was really cool to have him.
Yeah.
You know, and we had had three dreams that he was going to have a word for us.
Wow.
At the gathering. And didn't know what that was, but he ended up showing up an hour early for a session. We're in a side tent. He goes, that's okay. He goes, I got something.
Wow.
So he starts to share. It's about 20 of us crammed in this small tent, and he just starts to share. And he shares, like, first of all, gives us, like, warnings and some real intense stuff. But in the middle of it, he says, you're going to be part of tent gatherings. He starts describing these tent cities.
Wow.
Where the youth of America are going to gather. He's like, it's going to be porta-johns and hot dog stands beyond your wildest imagination. Literally, that's the quote. And he goes, it's worship, it's prayer, it's prophetic, it's a Holy Spirit Woodstock, it's a new Jesus movement. These are all the phrases that he's saying. And when he finishes, man, like, our whole team goes into a full-fledged encounter with God.
Come
I mean,
on.
Like no exaggeration, no hype. The Spirit of the Lord falls on this group under this little tent, and we're like sobbing. I mean, wailing.
Wow.
On the ground, wailing for, I don't know, maybe it was an hour, maybe it was less, I'm not sure. But we were wailing on the ground, just sovereignly. And we got up off that thing, and I was like, man, whatever that was
right.
Sovereign. It was so the Lord. So we just sat on this word. Tent cities, new Jesus movement, Holy Spirit Woodstock, you know, Porta Johns and hot dog stands, you know, just the whole thing. We were like, no idea what this means.
Wow.
It was just like the word of the Lord. And because we had three or four tents set up on that farm. And I'm thinking, like, that's about as much as I can handle. You know, it's a few thousand people, three or four tents. I'm like, done.
Yeah.
I mean, it about burned our team up, set up four tents, you know. And so I'm thinking tent gatherings and, like, you know, the youth of America, the guy in the wildest imagination, all these things. I'm like, man. So long and short of it is 2013, we're in 21 days of prayer down around the clock, 21 days around the clock. And this guy has a dream. And basically, he walks up to me in the dream and he says, we should combine gatherings on the East Coast. And I turn to him and say, it's impossible in the dream. And the Lord comes behind, voice of the Lord, thunderous voice of the Lord in the dream, and he says, I will gather.
Wow.
And the Lord just speaks all these phrases about this gathering on the East Coast. And he talks about the streams coming together. And the Lord says, with men it's impossible, but I will do.
Come on.
So I go, okay, so there's gatherings. And I think it's plural, but there was gatherings that he was talking to us about.
Right.
And I'm thinking about Bob Jones' word. I'm like, there's something going on right now. And so the story just goes crazy on us. I mean, like, literally it would take me an hour, and I won't do that. But it was like word after word. I mean, literally to the point of I texted Lou Engel, who leads the call. So he's done stadiums and, you know, Azusa Now and all that stuff. This was before Azusa Now, but I texted him and I said, hey, we're getting all this stuff on gatherings in the East Coast, National Mall. Is anything going on? I just wanted to see if anything was happening. He goes, man, I just prophesied this. I said, can I fly to California and just, you know, be that guy that gets on an airplane because of a set of dreams, you know?
Yeah.
And land in California and just talk and see if God will show us something. So he's like, let's do it. We set up a meeting with Andy Bird, Circuit Riders, and Lou and me. Just booked the thing. I booked the flight, like, I don't know, 2 days, 3 days later, this prophetic guy calls and he goes, hey, I dreamed that you were meeting with Andy Bird. I was like, well, yeah, I just booked the flight, you know? And he goes, the Lord says there's a gathering on the East Coast. And he even says almost the identical phrase. It's like, it's the 12 tribes coming together.
Wow.
And I'm like, unbelievable. He just almost quoted the dream. And he had no idea, you know, what's going out there. So I text him, like, you know, this guy Bob just prophesied this. And we get there in California, and it just really accelerates. I mean, I'm literally sitting across from Lou. We're talking about the mall, and my friend from Ohio texts me, and he goes, I dreamed last night that we were on the National Mall. There were tents everywhere. Lou was there playing guitar, weeping for a dream fulfilled. And I'm sitting across from Lou in Los Angeles, you know, going, unbelievable. I was like, I hadn't talked to the guy Isaac who texted me in, I don't know, a while, you know,
yeah.
out of the blue that night before, you know. So I said, man, like, this is the Lord. And I just kept telling Lou, I'm like, what do we do?
Right.
You know, when does a cool story with a bunch of dreams turn into obedience?
Yeah, that's good.
Like, it's not, you know, wow, the prophet told us about our dream.
Right.
You know, and there was more. I mean, there were multiple dreams on the same night. They're almost, I mean, the same time frame. They're almost identical dreams.
Wow.
Almost exact identical dreams about a shift.
Wow.
You know, it was like, okay, this is for real. So,
amazing.
So Lou turns to me and he goes, I feel like if you pull the trigger on something, well, that this is the Lord.
Yeah.
But he's like, you need to get a sense of faith that this, and to pull the trigger. And so I'm going 1 week fast in my life.
Yeah.
And let's just ask the Lord, because if we're to take a step of faith, you know, and like day three or four, guy sends me a note and he says, hey, I just dreamed that you were in a massive gathering, you were helping lead the gathering, and I walked up to you and I said, the Holy Spirit says, don't be afraid to do the new thing that he's talking about. So I'm like, that's like day three of my, like 1 week fast to seek the Lord. I'm like,
right.
This is God. So, you know, more stuff happened that confirmed it. I mean, I even went to Atlanta like a few weeks later with Lou. And I just said, it's like accelerated. God's talking to us.
Yeah.
And he says it again. He goes, you should pull the trigger. And he goes, let's talk to my friend Chris Berger. He goes, that's the next step. Let's talk to Chris. Hmm. And Chris lives in Kansas City. At the time he lived in Kansas City, we're in Atlanta. So I drop Lou off at this conference in Atlanta. I turn around and drive to the airport in Atlanta to fly back here to Virginia, and I'm standing in line for my flight, and I literally look up, and about almost as close as you are to me right now, Chris is standing there in front of me.
Wow.
That was Lou's final words. Your next step is to talk to Chris. I'm sitting there in line for the flight, and I look up, and he's like right there,
wow.
standing in front of me. And I went, I'm like,
without a prearranged meeting, he's just
unbelievable.
There.
Total divine coincidence. I'm like, this is the Lord.
Yeah.
And I'm kind of freaking out inside, like not wanting to say anything, you know, And so I was like, hey, Chris, you know, and we end up sitting next to each other on the flight.
Wow.
And he prophesies on this flight, like that 2017 is the year and all this stuff. And
wow.
So I felt like this is God, you know. It transitioned from nice story to this is obedience.
Right.
And even the idea of this thing is total wildness.
Absolutely.
Our plan right now is to set up 50 tents covering almost the entire National Mall, October 6th through 9th. It's going to realistically be more than 50 tents, because
right.
we have some regional tents and other things. So it's probably more like 60 tents, you know, and we're going to fill the National Mall and one tent for every state.
Amazing.
And right now as we speak, we have leadership teams on the ground in every state mobilizing worshipers, musicians, singers, artisans, dancers, evangelists, intercessors, just to converge on the National Mall. But this kind of expression has never been done. I mean, there's been amazing gatherings in the National Mall, but, you know, 60 tents all filled with day and night worship. That's just never happened.
Yeah.
And of course, our goal is not like just do something that's never happened.
Yeah.
But
get in the Guinness World.
But when we launched this thing, we realized it was like this idea of mobilizing America, not around a speaker, you know, not around the next, you know, hipster worship team, like not around anyone's name,
right?
But literally gathering around the worth of Jesus,
come on,
around the presence of God, and filling tents with worship day and night,
yeah.
And then just preaching the gospel, everything that breathes on the National Mall, and dreaming of a Jesus movement,
come on.
And this is one of those catalytic moments where it's like catching fire around America right now.
Yeah.
People are coming out of the woodwork everywhere. They're filling buses, you know, from the West Coast, from the Midwest, South, North. That we're getting stories, you know, somebody from North Carolina called me and said, we feel like we probably have 3,000 people. And like it from their state, they, you know. And
that's
and,
crazy.
And a lot of musicians and, you know, worship teams and leaders from around the nation just, you know, changing their schedule.
Come on.
People had international, like international trips, called and said, I have to change my whole schedule.
Wow.
I'm coming to the National, not even to be on a platform.
Wow.
And these are platform worthy leaders.
Yeah.
And they're like, I have to be there for this.
Yeah.
And so I don't know if it's gonna be how many people, you know, but ultimately this is an obedience thing. If it's 10,000 people, awesome.
Right.
If it's 50,000, awesome. If it's 5,000, awesome.
Yeah.
At this point. Because we feel like, and I think it's more than that, but the point is, this is like a divinely inspired moment.
Absolutely.
That God is breathing on, and it's never been done.
Yeah,
you know?
Absolutely.
And we picked the dates, October 69th, Jason Hershey leads David's tent,
yeah.
which is day and night worship on the mall for, you know, a year and a half.
Yeah.
And we picked the dates separately. We prayed, both got the same dates.
Wow.
We prayed October 69th.
That's crazy.
And we go to the National Park Service and pull, you know, reserve the dates. And he goes, we realized right as we were doing it that the dates we had were in the middle of the Feast of Tabernacles.
Wow.
Just total coincidence, you know?
That's awesome.
Which was, of course, that moment that God invited Israel to gather in tents. I mean, it's like just divine coincidence, you know?
Amazing.
Here we are in the middle of Feast of Tabernacles, calling America to our nation's capital in tents.
Yeah.
And just to worship and love Jesus.
Come on.
And host a dwelling place for his presence right there in the center of our nation. You know,
yeah.
It's amazing. And then we realized it was the 20-year anniversary of the Promise Keepers Gathering in 1997.
Wow, very cool.
Which, incidentally, is the biggest gathering in the history of the National Mall.
Yeah, over a million, right?
Over a million men gathered in October of 1997.
Wow.
So the first day of our permit with the Park Service was October 4th. That's load-in. And that's the day. That's the 20-year anniversary.
Wow.
Of the Promise Keepers.
Come
so
on.
We're filling it out with that date, you know. And I look on the wall of the National Park Service office, and it says this huge picture of Promise Keepers, of the Stand in the Gap Promise Keepers, and it says October 4th, 1997.
Mm.
20 years.
That's a holy moment.
Like 20 years. We didn't even realize. Here's a million-plus men that gathered just to pray for the destiny of America.
Come on.
I mean, and we accidentally stumble into a storyline that's bigger than us.
Yeah.
Accidentally do Feast of Tabernacles. Accidentally do, I mean, it's even the 50 years, you know, from the Jesus movement, the 1967, you know,
Summer
the outpouring, the Summer of Love, the charismatic movement in America. We, is, you know, stumbled into that 50-year anniversary of all of that.
Amazing.
So, like, we're in a divine moment.
Yeah.
And I don't know what's going to happen, but I believe the Lord is going to walk down that National Mall.
Come on.
That's what I believe is going to happen.
And come on.
I believe it's going to be healing. I believe it's going to be deliverance. I believe there's going to be just unusual sense of God's activity.
Yeah.
You know, around this. So, I don't know. There's 100 more stories.
Honestly. Yeah.
Like,
so excited.
I'm thinking as I'm talking, even my wife, my wife and I are just talking like last week.
Yeah.
I mean, not that we just talked.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah, we talk.
Good, so
we talk all the time. I mean,
week.
Usually daily.
Yeah, good. Praise God.
But we were just remembering when she was, before we were married, she was in her, you know, like early 20s. And she lived in Alabama. I lived here. So we weren't even dating. She's in Alabama and she has this dream that she's on the National Mall and worship is going on and she sees the Lord, Jesus, walk down the center of the National Mall.
Wow.
Vivid dream. And she wakes up and then, like, right after then, her pastor at the time, like, sits her down and is like, hey, what's God's will for your life? You know, what's your life vision? That kind of thing. And she goes, I don't know. But she goes, out of the blue, she starts prophesying to this guy. She goes, all I know is I'm going to be part of gatherings on the National Mall and Jesus is going to walk down the National Mall. That was like, we weren't even married. Nobody was talking about this, you know? Like,
crazy.
We just realized that, like, last week.
Yeah.
She'd remembered it. I'd forgotten. But she's like, you remember I dreamed about all of this before we were even engaged, before, you know, long before this was happening. So,
yeah,
that's amazing, man.
That is amazing.
She's got, like, this fingerprint of God on this where, you know, like I said, I don't know how many thousands it's going to be. And ultimately, in a sense, I don't care.
Doesn't matter.
Because if Jesus walks down that National Mall, everything changes.
Come on.
I mean, everything changes.
Yeah.
And so we're partnering with The Call, you know, with Lou, and the final day is going to be a whole other story, because the final day is called Rise Up. So the first 3 days,
October
6th through 8th, it's hot off the press. So
hallelujah.
October 6th through 8th.
You're hearing it first at Love Rival TV.
There you go, man. Be there. October 6th through 8th is Awaken the Dawn with Tent City. So it's those 3 days. That's the 50 plus tents, round the clock worship. The big psalm we're using is Psalm 68, where the ark goes into the nation's capital.
Come on. You know?
So let God arise. Yeah. You know, that kind of thing. And then the final day is the call. It's the call, brand with the call, but it's called Rise Up. And what we're doing is inviting hundreds of thousands of women to gather on that final day.
I'm about to have my own moment right now, but go ahead. Like, I'm going to tell you something.
And really pray, you know, for the new Jesus movement. This is out of left field. I mean, we planned this thing, and Lou was already, we were working with the call, you know, we were moving forward, and it was going to be a different kind of day, the final day. And then the Lord, sovereign, I mean, it's like the hour-long story, but three or four moments where God spoke so clearly about the women of America taking their place in places of influence and taking their place in intercession for the birthing of sons and daughters. You know, it's amazing. It's an amazing story.
I gotta tell you something now.
Yeah.
So I did not know about this. The rival, that's a whole new, I didn't know anything had to do with women or any of that. So I had a dream about a year and a half ago where I knew I was in the new Promise Keepers.
Really?
The new movement of Promise Keepers. And there was a man on a stage, I still don't know who this man was, and there's thousands of women there. And he points to me and he goes, I'm paraphrasing here, I've written down, I hadn't thought about this until just now. And he goes, just as men had a Promise Keepers movement, there's a new movement of women. There'll be the Promise Keepers women's movement. And I believe we were on the mall. There was millions of people there, it was packed out. And then they started praying for me individually. And started just prophesying over me of raising up women to preach the gospel, heal the sick, to raise the dead.
Yeah.
And to be honest, this is kind of the funny thing about it. At the time, this was maybe 2 years ago, I wasn't sure how I felt even. I just hadn't studied the issue about women in ministry, things like that. And you know, I was like, well, I like Catherine Coleman, I like Heidi Baker, so that's good enough for me. And then after that, I won this like long like theological study of it, and I'm like so all about it. And so that's, man, I'm having my own.
I'll tell you what, man, like that, here's a little tidbit on that moment.
Yeah.
So there's a guy named Francis Frangipane. I've read a bunch of books. He was teaching on revival.
Okay.
And in his like study of revival history, he realized pretty much every significant culture shifting move of God that you can identify had it like an identifiable prayer movement around it.
Right.
You know, so Great Awakenings. Yeah, I mean, the Great Awakenings, the Azusa Outpouring, all these things. There's this identifiable, organized, massive, a lot of times massive, sometimes not, but identifiable prayer movement.
Right.
Like, real clear. And he couldn't find one for the Jesus movement in the late 60s, early 70s. You know, he's like, it's so odd to me that there was this outpouring of the love of God on a generation in a unique way, now known as the Jesus movement. And he couldn't find, where's the prayer movement? And so he asked the Lord, he goes, Lord, where was the prayer movement? And he'll listen to what the Lord said to him. He goes, that was the answer to the prayers of a million praying moms.
Come on.
A whole generation went off the rail into rebellion, you know, in the cultural revolution of the 60s.
Right.
Drugs, you know, the whole deal. They went off the rail.
Yeah.
And a million moms hit their face and said, not my son.
Come on.
Not my daughter. Yeah. And it was those prayers that shifted heaven and birthed a new Jesus movement.
Come on.
I mean, the initial Jesus movement. And so here we are calling America to a tent city, host the presence of God. Can you imagine what this is going to feel like?
Yeah.
And then on that final day, Lord willing, hundreds of thousands of women descend on the National Mall and basically say the same thing those moms said.
Yeah.
Not my son and daughter.
Yeah.
And the voices, and it's almost like the Jesus response to a cultural narrative.
That's right.
That's going on right now in America where, you know, there's a lot of frustrated women in America right now. And God is like saying, God's calling the women out. And it's not just a women's movement. It's a Jesus movement.
It's everybody.
That's the thing. It's like that final day is not just for women. It's for everybody. The whole thing's for everybody.
Wow.
We're calling college students, like millennials, high school students, come and fill tents, bring your band, bring your djembes, bring your guitars, throw into buses, throw into vans, take a spot in the tents.
Yeah.
You know, you're not just going to come and just watch a stage.
Right.
You're going to take spots and lead worship and sing your songs. And like, this is for everybody. Bring your offering of love, you know. And then in the middle of all of that, you get this Jesus movement, you know, thing, and God's calling the women to take their place. And so we have this partnership now with these first 3 days with the tent city, the last day with this women's deal, and man, the hand of the Lord is on this women's thing. I mean, it is uncanny how people have been hearing God in this.
Wow.
You know? Like,
wow.
There was even a girl who Lou, just one of Lou's leaders, was just telling me yesterday, who went on a, she was reading about Deborah and Esther, you know, and she went on this like 21-day fast just for the Deborahs to like take their place in America.
Yeah.
She had no idea what was brewing, you know?
Right.
And she's like, man, I just finished a 21-day fast asking the Lord for this exact thing, and then bam, the Lord breathes on it and we are seeing something happen. So it's Awaken the Dawn for 3 days, October 6th through 8th, and then October 9th is called Rise Up, and that's going to focus on this sound coming out of the women of America to turn the nation, and it's gonna be a wild 4 days.
Come on!
I mean, this thing is like totally out of control. Right?
Conference mode on steroids.
Oh man, it's like conference mode on. It's even like, I mean, right now just the mobilization of this.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it, like, God, you have to do this. You know, but He's doing it. I mean, one of our leaders had another dream. I know we're like telling like it's like fire hose, drink from the fire hose of dreams.
That's good.
But she's standing on the National Mall. This was a couple months ago, and the Lord walks up next to her. Jesus walks up next to her, and all He says is this: "I am leading a procession to the National Mall." That's all He says, and she wakes up and it's like, "That's the Lord."
Wow.
It's like Jesus is doing things around us that we could never do.
Come on, I mean, so good.
So. It's awesome.
Amazing. I think we could keep this going for another hour. This is so good. And I love IHOP's prophetic history. I've listened to every single available story on that probably 20 times.
That's pretty wild.
Yeah. And I'm feeling a lot of the same things. What God did in KC and, you know, Habakkuk 3, you know, Jesus going down the street with lightning coming from his hands.
Yeah.
And there's a similar feel here. So I'm excited. And we've got about 30 seconds, but you know, when we go with this episode and everything, there will be links at the bottom of the page for sign-ups, all those sorts of things. Want to help them get that out to as many people. So we encourage you. God is moving in America. Don't get your prophetic words from Fox or CNN or MSNBC. This is what God is doing in America. This is one of the many things that God is doing in America. So we bless you and jump in to what He's doing. Have a wonderful day.